I'm back at Downicary, meeting Derek Gow, who's running the site for us.
Now look, I'm not normally someone who likes to embarrass my interviewees on camera, but I'm about to do that to the one and only Derek Gow. Derek is one of the most important, the greatest conservationist in the UK at the moment, because Derek can talk, and we do talk quite a lot.
We do.
But Derek is a doer. He gets things done. He makes a difference. And so few people do that, that he is in fact a legend.
Thank you, Chris.
A legend. Oh, you're not too embarrassed. Honestly, so good to be working with you here. So what have we been up to? I mean, scarification at the back here.
Yeah, so what we're doing is we're basically preparing these seed beds now for wildflowers and herbs. Tay's been going around collecting a myriad of seeds, principally a lot of yellow rattle in them, start weakening us grass, but knapweeds, fleabanes, a whole host of wildflowers that are now just growing in the road verges. So what we're going to do is we're putting the pollen back. We put the pollen back, we get the bees, we get the insects, and then that's one guild of life, and we start to look at what we're going to do.
And we've got to get rid of all the grass. We've got to do this scarification because, I mean, this is what we started with, boring turf.
Yeah.
And if you put wildflower seed on here, it's just not going to compete with the boring turf. It won't get through.
No, it absolutely won't. I mean, this basically will mat everything. It'll probably mat the trees for a very long time as well. I mean, the trees are coming from the edges, which is real good, but this is just a carpet of death.
Yeah, carpet of death.
So we've got to look at, you know, how we give it a hand.
Lesson here for you at home, if you're interested in putting a little wildflower patch in your garden, you've got to get rid of your boring lawn first. You've got to do what, you know, Derek and Tay have been doing here, which is get rid of that. Okay, so wildflowers are going in, loads of insects, that'd be great for birds, bats, everything, of course.
Yeah.
Nest making over here for a very different type of animal, though.
There are grass snakes on the land, and what we're doing with this is we're providing them with, you know, really, you know, warm, decaying, massive material that they can lay their eggs in.
Yep. In summertime, lay a batch of about 20 eggs in there. The heat generated by this decaying plant matter is what does all of the incubation for them. And of course, grass snakes will be perfect in this environment, particularly because one of the other things that you've been doing is putting in some ponds. Plenty of amphibians, newts, they love munching on those, of course.
Yeah. Well, we've got, I mean, like all the amphibian guilds here, we've got common toads, common frogs, smooth newts, palmate newts, but we're also really keen to start reintroducing water frogs, because if you put the water frogs back in here, it seems pretty crazy, as you know, to call a water frog. But these things, the things that the northern pool frogs, cluster around the edge of water bodies, and they're super productive. So just over the road there's a series of ponds on a colleague of mine's land, and for the last couple of years he's got ponds where the common frogs aggregate. There are great white egrets feeding there, but they have nowhere to breed. So one of the things we want to do, and we're trying to do by changing the structure, is look at a landscape and say, it's for you. You come here, we will look after you. So getting the food for them right, a bigger array of amphibians, then we might one day be standing here in 5-6 years time watching young great white egrets go up.
What about these refugia here, Derek? Because you've piled up, you know, concrete, some earth, there's some metal in there. It may look a bit like a sort of a scrapyard, but it's brilliant for wildlife.
Yeah, it is. So all the concrete that's exposed is typically 2 to 3 degrees warmer than the surface of the land around it. The insects like to come and bask on that. When the insects bask on that, then you get things like common lizards coming back into there. If you can get the common lizards started again, then that'd be they in their own turn become a prey species for things like adders. So the adders here, virtually all but gone. And what we want to do is, you know, start to ignite everything that's going to provide food. We're pressing the buttons to reignite their living space so that basically we're laying the table for what comes next. So these are the old railway posts from the line that's hidden in the forest. We took them out, smashed them, and there they are, creating living space for lizards.
Okay, now some people could look at this and say, you had a perfectly nice green grass field and you've turned it into a bit of a bomb site. We can't rush nature. There will be almost immediate improvements here, but we're going to need to give this a couple of seasons before it really gets into its stride.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when the guys who are pretty aware have been down here doing all the work, you know, what you have a good dragonfly complement where the river is, lots of demoiselles, banded, and common. So the dragonflies are pretty good, hardly a butterfly, tiny numbers of sand martens, which we'd really, I mean, the big mounds in the back are to give them more nesting space, but it's pretty impoverished. Looks pretty, but not much living here.
No, not now, but in the future.
in the future there'll be a lot.
Okay, that's and you're going to keep doing what you do best, which is doing things.
That's the idea.
Brilliant. Perfect.
Okay.
Really nice.